Winston Churchill once said, personally, I'm always ready to learn. However, I don't always like being taught. What's the difference? This statement really made me thinking. Is it about who it is or what it is? Or do we see strength in the learning and the weakness in being taught? I don't know. Over to you.
The ViaMia show is sponsored by the following people.
Talking about receiving or passing on our knowledge, yeah, the teachers would be probably one of those, but there is somebody very similar to that in a similar field. A facilitator, career, a certified career development practitioner, Ken Boyd. Ken, welcome. And thank you very much.
Here.
And like I was telling you, your credentials, they're going to break my tongue. And this is what happened. Yes, well, we were talking about you're a facilitator. And we were talking also at the beginning, if you remember a little bit, those words, the sentences I was using in the show intro about learning mm-hmm. and being taught differences. Mm-hmm. How would you respond to that?
Well, to me, it's who's teaching and how are they doing it, right?
Yeah.
I'm a lifelong learner. I love learning. Some of us are participatory learners. We learn in groups. I'm a visual learner. Everybody has a different approach to how they learn. But in that sense that I think, Mia, it's how it depends on the teacher. We've all had teachers in school that stand out amongst the others. Mm-hmm. Everybody taught us for those years in school. But why is it those certain teachers stood out? Okay. It's how it's delivered.
Well, definitely you go through all the package, learning, being taught, and teaching, all of that. You have to study, that means you're learning, otherwise you can't pass on your information.
Absolutely.
You're teaching, you've been taught, right? Is it any preference, any of these activities? What do you like the most?
Like I said, I'm a visual learner. I love a group environment to be taught that way.
Mm-hmm.
I like an environment where people motivate themselves and we learn our that way. You know what
I'm saying? You like the learning
yeah.
process.
And
you
I'm
like
not learning. A teacher, like as you pointed
You're
out,
not a
I'm
teacher.
A facilitator.
And I wanted
I present,
to get there.
I present
yeah,
information.
There is a line, there is a difference between teaching
yes.
and facilitating. So
yeah.
Who is facilitator, who is a teacher?
Well, we know who a teacher is, right? A facilitator presents information, passes it along, and we have a way of doing it, our own individual way, as do teachers. So people say to me, hey man, you're a really cool teacher. I really liked your program that week, or I loved being with you that week. You're a great teacher. I go, thanks, but I'm not a teacher. I'm a facilitator. I facilitate the workshops, and I present information. And again, it's how you do it.
You sort of challenge them to the people, and they have to do their homework, obviously. They have to
yeah.
finish it, so they...
Which is like teaching.
Yeah, sort of, yeah. You work for a company
mm-hmm.
as a facilitator, and the company's name is Avia Employment Services.
Yes.
We can find more about that particular service or that particular place where a company where Ken is and about him. If we go to aviaemploymentservices.ca,
mm-hmm.
and I know you just got there recently, went through different places, different facilitating places,
mm-hmm.
and I know how good facilitator you are. That's why you're here. I experienced
Thank you,
as a facilitator, and I just wanted to know your role as a facilitator. You already briefly said it, what the facilitator does, what teacher does. But what is your role? What your day looks like?
Good question. I do workshops, like mainly job search workshops for people, because that's a whole thing that people don't get when you're working, because we're comfortable doing our routine in life. We got a gig, then we get laid off, then all of a sudden we're unemployed, and then all of a sudden it's like, what do I
then
gotta
do? Then you become
get a
in
resume?
That class.
What is that? Yeah, because in radio, my, you know, I never had a resume, so a lot, many people don't. I still meet people who've had that life job. They got it at 17, and they've worked 32 years at that company, and then last Friday, boom. Laid off. They've never had a resume. They've never done interview skills. They never even thought about it, because I said their life was comfortable and now it's not comfortable, so they're in transition and change, right? So job search is all about that. It's about how to market yourself. You're the product, it's product knowledge. And if we don't know that, we're done.
Well, you're talking about people, they never had a resume. Well, look how many years ago how people lived. They started the first job in the early 20s and they finished with it.
That's right.
For 30, 40 years, and now how long people keep one job?
Well, actually in Canada, the average is about 3.5 years at one company. In the United States of America, it's 2.5 years. Surprise!
So
and
why is
they
that?
Expect people, 12 years ago, the theory was that people would have 5 to 7 different career changes in a lifetime. Now it's 7 to 14 by the time you're 38.
Wow.
7 to 14 different careers by the time you don't even hit 40 yet.
It's like
things look different, don't they?
You're falling asleep as a teacher, wake up as an actor.
Man, reinvent yourself.
But you know, sometimes the people use the transferable skills, so they stay in a similar field. But many times, people go to completely different field.
Yeah, I love that phrase, because it just seems so cliche for job search. You know, transferable skills.
But
in truth, I'm using all my skills from my back, my moment before, my backstory, my whole life before.
Oh, we'll
talk
there.
About that.
That's very
but I am using all those skills to. That are transferable for this position as a facilitator.
Well, you're facing several people every day in a class. How many people you usually have?
Up to 20. I'm
20
on a regular basis.
And who are your students?
The people are unemployed people from the age of 16 to 83. You know, but I mean, and seriously, that's the demographic.
My.
They're coming through the door, and some of those people, as you mentioned, are the people that have had that job for 15 to 30 years, and they thought it would be forever.
Mm-hmm.
And they're unemployed, and they just, as they say, they're ill suited or ill prepared to go look for work, right?
And are they mostly immigrants? Because I remember when I met you, the class was filled with more. Is that right? Like people.
Well, yes. I mean, obviously we have an immigrant population, but it's everybody really. And when I met you, there was a lot. I've worked with people from all over the world, from different socioeconomic backgrounds, right? The thing that's the magical thing is we're all human beings, we all have feelings. We all have hearts and brains, and we all have that thing going on. Either we're motivated or not. We're on that emotional roller coaster of unemployment. It doesn't matter where you're in, how old you are, or anything, where you're from. It's all, people are the same.
Right? I don't know, I was going somewhere with the question about the immigrants, because I've been in the places where immigrants, like we're saying, and you know, they're educated, skillful people, came with great credentials, but they are not recognized here.
I know, it's tough. I worked with two doctors in their 40s from Bosnia. They're both doctors, married, with two teenage kids here. And it was interesting, I thought, you know, if somebody had a heart attack in the workshop, they could save their life, but they couldn't get a gig in a hospital in Vancouver.
My.
You know, they have to go through the ropes and do whatever they have to do that. Biologists from Brazil, and I could just keep going on and on and on and on about people I've met and worked with in my workshops, including the life skills workshops.
Okay, so why these people, let's say, maybe using too strong word, promised come to live in this country and, you know, show your skills and work in your environment, in your field, they come here and they can't.
Yeah, difficult. It's like me, I just think about it. If I was to be a facilitator in Australia or somewhere else in the world, for example, what would I need? What kind of extra training would I need, even though I've done it here for 8 years?
Mm-hmm.
Probably the same thing, right? Similar yet different.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, I graduated from psychology when I came here, and I realized what I have to go through again. I'm like, I already was in the school for 4 years. It's not that I don't like to learn.
Yep.
And there was a lot of money involved as well. I'm not saying that people coming from different world and right away they jumped in their field, because I'm sure they're different terminology, you know, there's a lot of things that are different, but I'm not responsible for this, and I don't have any maybe right to say, but maybe they should be some exams and let you show us what you can do.
Yeah.
instead of just go back to 2 to 4 years to the school.
I agree. It's a stumbling block. It's definitely an obstacle for sure.
Everything is changing, economy and things. How is the future for facilitators? How do you see it?
Well, hopefully I can work with people because I'm that people person. I have been all my life.
Really?
Yeah, you know that. So I hopefully will have a group of people I can work with and interact with, and they can work together in the room. I've been told that Skyping, we're going to be doing the facilitating on Skype. You'll have 10 or 12 clients on Skype doing it that way. Who knows? It's all coming up, right? But nothing stays the same.
But that's what it is. We need the interaction. We need to sit and talk to people.
Oh, absolutely.
We don't want to sit and talk to the computer all the time, even when I see you there on the screen. It's not the same.
It isn't. And it's an absolute fact that when people are in a group, they do motivate themselves. They become more successful. And maybe you recently heard there's people that are independent, you know, entrepreneurs at home, you know, home-based businesses. These people are renting rooms together now, collectively. Why? They don't want to be at home alone. Hard to motivate yourself, right? Self-motivation. So they're renting spaces with other entrepreneurs and business people to stay motivated. Mm-hmm. And I believe that's the truth, and that's why the workshops work. As opposed to, like you said, sitting home alone, as I used to joke about, wrapped in a blanket, watching Jerry Springer, looking for lurk and hitting send all the time, send, just looking at ads and randomly trying to get a random gig.
Yeah.
Not very successful.
No.
And people, that's what we do first.
And the great benefit is to have you as a facilitator. You are absolutely wonderful.
Thank you.
You are not only, you don't only know, you know, your stuff, but you just make that that class motivated, and people loved listening to you, and you put your own stories, and you know, just people can compare. It's also, like I said, networking. People in the class, they may help to each other, okay? Mm-hmm. Somebody's looking for a work, but the other one may know somebody in that field.
Absolutely, and Mia, it happens so often, doesn't it?
Doesn't it?
Yep, they talk to somebody, and you know, from their social media thing or something, and they hook them up together, and you get employment. And sometimes a wonderful opportunity shows up that they never even dreamt of. Mm-hmm. You know, you're looking for that for now job, you know, and there's something honorable about that too. If you have to pay, you know, rent and feed the kids, I mean, you can find the love in that. But they meet people who know somebody else through networking, and they get an opportunity
they
never imagined. Because if you would have told me 12 years ago, I would have been a facilitator, I would have said, "What's that?" Seriously, right?
Well, the same thing before we started. I told you 3 years ago I was in Douglas College taking course.
Yes.
You had better name for it, but to me it was sort of like self-discovery course. But people are not looking for work. They're looking for themselves. They get to the point that I'm done with this, what I've done, now what? Like, I felt like I can do so many things. I can do this. I have this kind of degree and this training. And after 2 weeks, I come up with broadcasting announcing, like you said. 4 years ago, if you told me I'm going to be sitting here, no, I don't think that we would get along, Ken. And that's all those, and that course, again, doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah, it was like a CDM, probably a career decision-making course. Right, and we do have that, too. We do Career Exploration Week, right, where people, and you're right, Mia, you're bang on when you talk about, I used it, the term product knowledge. We need to know who we are, and then how do we present that? How do we market ourselves? How are we branding ourselves when we're looking for work? Or, you know, exploring new opportunities, right? It's like that if you and I were to go, anybody that buys a big ticket item, house, car, something big, chances are you're going to ask a lot of questions to a lot of people, at least somebody, and that person that has that product knowledge about what you want to purchase, right? You will make an informed decision based on what they say, so do employers.
Yeah.
They make the same decision the same way.
Well, we are going to talk about a little more how you were brought to this kind of stage. You had different stages where you stood before.
Oh, I had a few stages before.
Yes, and it's going to be very interesting what we're going to carry on with Ken Boyd, which is going to be after this short break. Stay tuned.
The ViaMia Show is sponsored by the following people.
So again, we're back with Ken Boyd, who is facilitator slash...
Career development practitioner.
You forget the certified.
So yes, I'm a certified
career
development
practitioner. That's the word that it's causing...
CCDP.
CCDP. And we can check the place where he is facilitating, aviaemploymentservices.ca, and that's the name. How long do they exist?
We've been in operation a year ago, April 2nd.
Year, so okay. I think that was a year ago that most of the places started.
The province changed, yes. Yeah. The employment services world looks different. Our industry has changed too. Mm-hmm. That's labor market information. We've gone from 411 service providers in British Columbia to 73. So essentially what you have in every municipality is a one-stop shopping for the unemployed. Mm-hmm. Whereas before you could go to different, you know, be yeah. referred to different services. Now it's
yeah,
condensed.
It's different. Yeah. So I studied something I didn't finish before we went to break, that stage where you're standing now on in your class, because you're still on the stage, you're there, yeah. you giving knowledge to people, but you're also you're bringing some entertainment so people don't fall asleep, and you're doing a very good job. You're really
Thank you.
Good in it. We had something else before. You started, and I remember you were telling me how everything started for you. You were working in a radio for many, many years.
Yes, I was in radio at 20.
Yeah.
24 years in radio, and been acting 30 years, film and theater.
You see?
Voiceover work.
So I guess the stage is your home.
It's just a role I'm playing as facilitator, mm-hmm. And it just looks different. Yes, the stage is there, it just
yeah.
looks different.
Yeah.
It, to me, it's like stand-up comedy with a message.
That's right.
Right?
That's good way
so I'm using, as I mentioned earlier, all those transferable skills from that last life to this one, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I worked on cruise ships as a guest entertainer, done all that stuff, right?
Yeah. So you also work for JR. I mean, there are quite a few stations you were working for.
WX 1130, yeah. 89.5 The Hawk, Chilliwack.
And... how we met, I asked you to be a guest on my show on the radio. It was over 2 years ago, which went fine. But then because I liked your you being there as a guest, so we repeated the show. I don't know if you remember. You were supposed to be my co-host. But what happened to us? as soon as we sat down, we started to broadcast. We had 1.5 hour for the show. 2 minutes after, all system shut down and nothing worked except our microphones. Ken was under the table trying to figure out the cables. Nothing worked, and 1.5 script, which I was working almost 2 weeks for, went to garbage. Like nothing really. We were improvising. Ken was asking me questions. I was responding. Oh, I have actually demonstrated. I would like to demonstrate something which you probably forgot, Ken. I brought one little short audio clip here because. That would be example how the interview with Ken looked like. He asked question, but he never let me finish. There was no way I had the space for it, and it sounded like this.
The stuff we want to hear about.
Dating.
Tell us
why
about the you know the process over there at home, meaning that, and then you know here. What's the difference?
Why don't
what's
you,
it look like here compared to there? Are we more aggressive guys? Are we not? Are we more conservative? What are the women like? Are you guys you women
okay.
over there more aggressive?
Can you be more specific? Aggressive where?
Well, you know what I'm saying. Like, hey, babe, you want to go out, or is it more politely done, or do you guys have like where you're in a social environment back home in Slovakia? Would a guy walk up to you across the street and or across the bar? Or something and say, hey, you're a very pretty lady. What's your name?
Would
you like to go for coffee? Does that actually happen over there or no?
I would say in my culture, it's done a little more gentle.
Okay,
way.
Give me an example of that.
Here, men have no
like
problem.
No.
Oh. You know.
Oh, what, write a note and make an airplane and throw it over
well,
to you?
Well, can you ask a question? Are you going to let me please answer?
All right, then.
Okay. So, yes, I would say more gentle. That means here, a man has no problem to come to me and say, can you give me your cell phone number? Or are you married? Or do you want to go for coffee? And I find it very rude at the beginning. Now I don't. I got used to it, but definitely is no is the answer. In Slovakia, I never got that kind of approach.
What do they do there?
It takes a guy a little...
Do they meet your parents first?
You know, Ken, I really... You're not giving me a chance to talk.
All right.
Talk show without music.
So, does it sound familiar to you?
It does. I remember that day.
Yeah, it was 2 years ago. And this is how it sounded like for 1.5 hour. Ken asked question. There were some attempts to respond, but I didn't really succeed much. This is a typical radio person. I mean, working in a radio, you have only one tool, and you have to use it, and you do think use it feet. Pretty well.
Thank you. Yeah, think it on your feet.
The voice. Yeah. If we can briefly go to your radio days, because sure. you still worked in the traditional radio and then digital era.
Yes.
You were in both.
I started off playing records. Yes. I'm dating myself. I don't want to talk about it. Records and then CDs, and then we went digital in 92, and I remember we didn't go to school for it. It was like, you know what, it's coming in, so get used to it. And we were all freaking out about a computer, like, you know, they covered our turntables up, and there's no CDs anymore, and it was like, these keyboards, what is that going to look like? They had these yellow happy signs around all over every computer in the radio station, and it said, smile, damn it, you work in radio, P.S., you can't break it. Because we were all afraid if you hit the wrong button, you'd stop the SkyTrain in New West, right? And we did. And, I mean, I went off the air. They said, just call the engineer, and I called the engineer, and he's having dinner at home with his wife. I says, what am I supposed to do? He's like, just, you have to reboot it. And I'm like, boot what? You know, I was thinking, freaking right out.
So you want to tell me that what happened to us, that happened to you before?
Oh, absolutely. Off the air, alarms go off, all that stuff.
And then what?
And it was so weird because when I went to a Chilliwack radio station, 89.5 The Hawk, in 2009, they were building the control room, Mia, and it was all screens except the slide pods, right? It was just so different, right? All digital. It was just crazy. Yeah, your commercials here, your music here, it was just crazy cool.
Well, the people, they worked in the traditional radio for many, many years. They kind of found it difficult to remain in the radio when it all changed.
Yes, a lot of people did.
Some people left, what I know. But microphone is, you know, when we're talking about using only one tool, I find working in the radio, I find it interesting because it's challenging. It really challenges you.
Well, you're painting pictures with words.
That's exactly. I really love that. I use it many times because it does make sense what you just said. When we have 1-2 second silence here, at least everybody see and knows what's happening. You have 2 seconds quiet silence in the radio, it feels like half an hour.
It feels like forever.
Yeah, it's yeah. So you have to do as much as you can with that voice, right?
Yeah.
And we went through facilitating your stage, another stage, being behind a microphone. Do you miss microphone?
I don't really. I've moved on past it. You know, I would never say never for radio, but I've done it. I lived it, you know, and I loved The Hawk when I was there in 2009, but I was on the air and I just was like, wow, I've been here, done this. My values have changed. My life has changed. You know what I mean? It looks different. Mm-hmm. So I have no regrets. Love radio, love show business, all that stuff. I still act in local theater and do plays and stuff like that, which
is
just
so I wanted to kind of move to the other level, stage, another
stage. I just want to answer your question and say, yes, I love radio. And
well,
I
realize that you won't probably let me even ask the questions. All you're right. going to respond. And we heard it as a sample before. Another stage. You do act?
Yes.
You play in a place, a theater.
Yeah.
Another hobby of yours, a passion, is what I know, it's painting.
Yes, I do paint.
How does that go on now?
I love it. I mean, you know what? It's funny, my career development field as a facilitator, I point that out to people, is you can do what you love and make a living at it, great. Mm-hmm. However, find the love in what you do and then do what you love anyway, because interests are not random. And I was painting and drawing when I was a kid 100 million years ago. And I took it up.
You look pretty good for that.
Oh, thank you. I took it up like 5 or 6 years ago, and I love it. I love mm-hmm. painting, right? Mm-hmm. And it's something I love to do. It's like acting. I do it for free in community theater. Just finished a play. Love it. And yet I've been paid for it as well, right?
Yeah. So you have the painting, you have acting, the radio, facilitating, and all of them, like we were using the transferable skills because they are there, right? Mm-hmm. Interacting, talking to people, working with people. Is it anything you would say, this is still standing out, even though I love everything else, but this stands out?
I can't really. You know what? I love them all. I love painting right now. What I'm currently doing is painting, and I love doing, like as I said, plays. Acting has always been a love of mine. So, yeah, I'm gonna keep doing these things because I love doing them. So, mm-hmm. acting, painting.
Do you have, I mean, it was very difficult, I have to tell everybody, to get Ken here. It was the most difficult guest to get. Every single time when I had him scheduled, he suddenly said, I'm sorry, I'm busy. So there is always either acting, there was always something. So you're busy even like daytimes, obviously, weekdays you work.
Yeah.
Weekends you do the other part.
And I just finished a play at the Langley Playhouse, so God of Carnage, which I saw the New York cast do 2 years ago in L.A., mm-hmm. and I knew if they ever auditioned that, I'd like that. So I got a role in that. I was fortunate, right? So that was a good run, but that's like 3 months of your life because you rehearse for six, you're up running for 5 week run. Mm-hmm.
Part is of there festival. Any place we can find your activities?
Pardon?
If there's any place on the website, we can see the other part of you. Is it any other website you can?
My Facebook.
Oh, Facebook, okay.
Not LinkedIn, but my Facebook you could.
Okay.
And my website, I have a website too, right?
Okay.
www.krboyd.com.
Okay, so that's another place if you would like to find him. And I know 2 years ago I met you, there was some wine tasting, you were sitting there with your pictures, selling pictures. You still do that? It was somewhere in Langley, or Surrey.
No.
You don't do that
anymore? Oh, you mean the art gallery?
Yeah.
Yeah, the Fort Gallery, that's where I had a show, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. And I still do that. I just sold 2 pieces in the theater during the run of the play.
So you walk with your paintings everywhere you
walk? You paint pictures with words on paper with resumes. You paint pictures with words as a facilitator. And I paint pictures with
oils.
You're
a great painter, that's for
Thank
sure.
You.
That's for sure. And let's go at the end. Unfortunately, we have to close the show soon. So before we do that, the way I know you, the way I remember you, and the half hour we were listening to Ken, my opinion is the world should know about you. And
Thank you.
The world is not ending, so you still have time, but hurry up, okay? And I'm just thinking because I can easily see you as a motivational speaker. There are so many things it would be really good. Not because you're good at it, but because it will be benefit for all of us, for a lot of people. They're lost, they're looking for it. They need some reboosting or recharging battery, and it would be really good for that.
Thank you, Mia. I'd love to do that work, and I've done a little bit of that already. Want to do more, so.
Ken, before you go, you need to place your valuable signature on the third season, our cup,
Yay.
Please.
Cool.
Thank you so much, Ken. Before I thank you to all of you, I'd like to have a very quick announcement again about the internet radio ViaMia talk show, which we're doing every Thursday. Please come and join us every Thursday at 9 o'clock in the evening. More information will be found on www.viamia.net, and it can be heard online. We are here for you who would like to be heard, who's dealing with different kind of issues, if it's behavioral issues or anything, nothing. It's about communication and understanding. Thank you again to Ken Boyd, and thank you for all of you who spend time with us on Channel 4. Thank you, bye-bye.